Press the bell icon so that you don't miss any updates from Workspace.
When I was making that film also, like during the whole process, even during the shoot and at the edit, I listened to people too. Like I listened to the suggestions of the people whom I worked with. And, you know, if they were, you know, if they appealed to me, if they sounded really good to me, I took those suggestions. And that's how, you know, got the final product.
So how are you doing, Don? How was it going?
Yeah, good. How are you?
We have a similar kind of setup with books, I guess. So hope I'm not intruding in your schedule. So let's do this now.
Not at all. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, great one. So let's start with your career, Don. Let's start with the interview, I guess. So the idea is you were into IT, right? You were in Sydney and all. So yeah. How did that journey into film begin? Like when did you choose to come back and what was the choice behind that?
Yeah, well, my degree was in physics, actually. I did my BSc in physics. Mm-hmm. Then only I went on to filmmaking, you know, mm-hmm. much later. Mm-hmm. But while I was doing my degree itself, I had this passion for film and I have written some scripts back then at that point. But they were very, you know, like substandard when I look back at them right now, like, you know, mm-hmm. from this point. But, you know, I might feel the same, you know, after a few years about these films as well, you know, we don't know. So, but, you know, I always, you know, wanted to do something, you know, more creative rather than just, you know, a 9 to 5 job, mm-hmm. which, you know, restricts you in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. So I did a few such jobs as well, eventually I wanted to do something where I had more control over what I'm doing and how I am doing it and, mm-hmm. you know, when I'm doing it, like all those stuff. And also, you know, when I looked at, you know, it could be writing or it could be filmmaking. It can be anything that's productive. But, you know, I had to learn, like, if I want to be a filmmaker, I had to learn the craft. So I joined a film school later and, you know, I did my research on stuff and, you know, I started making films eventually.
Okay. So the first work I have seen of yours was Savamvet. You've done a lot of documentaries and short film work before that, which I did my research on, but I've not seen them. But with Savam, what was the idea behind it? Why did you think this is the movie that I have to make?
Yeah. You know, when back when I was in my film school itself, I had some idea about making a movie about how people behave. Like, you know, the particular way in which people behave in Kerala, like in, mm-hmm. especially in my community, the community that I come from. So that's where the, you know, the beginning of that, you know, that idea is from. But mm-hmm. later I thought, okay, we need a situation to place all this. And, you know, I didn't want a story. I didn't want to, you know, go back to the same, you know, the dramatic structure. So mm-hmm. I wanted to experiment something on the experiment on, you know, what is holding a film. Mm-hmm. And it should, I had this idea of it shouldn't be just a story. It should be something different. So I thought, okay, one event would be enough. Like, you know, like from a night to like one night and one day of at a funeral house. Mm-hmm. Like, so, you know, I tried to play with that and I, you know, that's how I got there. Like later, you know, like when it was full of challenges and it was not like anything that I had done before. So it has to be like, for me, like when I make a film, it should be watchable for me too. Like, you know, like it should be, if somebody else makes a film like that, I should be able to go and sit there and enjoy that film. And that kind of entertainment, like not like typical, you know, like when I say the term enjoy or entertain, like it's not like, you know, like you should be able to laugh or anything. It should like, you should be able to, you know, in some way, like it's all entertainment one way or the other. So like that. So yeah, when I was making that film also, like during the whole process, even during the shoot and at the edit, I listened to people too. Like I listened to the suggestions of the people whom I worked with. Mm-hmm. And you know, if they were, you know, if they appealed to me, if they sounded really good to me, I took those suggestions, and that's how, you know, got the final product.
The thing with your first film, right, with Savam, it's very assured. Like it doesn't feel like a debut. It feels like someone who's like made this for a long time. So mm-hmm. what I wanted to ask about it is, there's certain things that you've reused, like those elements, like the black and white imagery or the lack of music and certain things. Was this always like that in your head when you're making Savam, or is it something that you built over the process of making it?
The style. Yeah, see, I'm someone who doesn't plan everything, you know, in advance. I'm someone who relies a lot on the process. You know, even with my script, I have written, I think for Savam, I have written around 8 or 9 drafts, different drafts for that script itself. Mm-hmm. So I keep working on it until I feel that, okay, I have something to go with, you know, like this is enough, or, mm-hmm. you know, I will be, you know, it will be an interesting movie right now if I shoot this. I have to reach that point. And it is not very easy to reach that point, you know, like with every draft, you will find some mistake. Like if I will, after writing a script, after writing one draft, I will leave it aside for a week or two and then come back to it. When I come back to it, I will see too many flaws in it. And maybe, you know, like after a month, I might see even more problems. So then I try to rectify it or improve it in, you know, different ways. I apply some methods and, you know, try to improve it. Then, you know, like, and when I'm shooting the film also, like, you know, like the text will be there, but I will try to add something to it. Something that would, you know, take it a little bit higher than it is or what it already is. So that's where the creative part comes in, I feel. Like, you know, I had already prepared a mud map for when I was shooting Savam. I had a mud map drawn out, and I, you know, I had all the movements of all the characters and all the, you know, camera movements and everything drawn out on it. But when we actually went to the shoot, I found that they were insufficient and I could have done something better. So I threw them away and I started, you know, making better ones. I felt that, you know, there is a possibility for a better movement or a better choreography, I felt. Mm-hmm. And that's how we went forward with that at that time.
Okay. Is there any scope
and
for that?
And definitely the suggestions of the DOP and other people, like even the sound people, they did help at that point.
Is there any scope for the actors to improvise with your dialogue or with your scenes?
Yeah. See, I had written the dialogues, but when I went there, I was not particularly very strict about what was being told and what was being spoken. So I told them that it's okay if they, you know, go a bit out of line from what is already written, so that, you know, as long as the meaning is kept and the dialogues were not too important for that film, because for that film it was all about, you know, the way it is being told and, you know, like the topics that are being discussed, other than like the major attention from, you know, the event is drifting away and people are talking more about themselves there. So as long as that idea is conveyed, I was not particularly strict about the dialogues. So they were given a lot of room for improvisation. And another thing is that we even improvised a couple of new scenes when we actually got onto the set. And, you know, like I told them, okay, you can, these are the situations, try to come up with something that you can relate to. And some of the actors did really well in that area. And, you know, I could use them in the final footage as well.
So now I'm going to make a claim. If you agree or don't agree, I'm just going to make a claim as a viewer of your film. With these three films, right, I put that in my article also. I felt like they were a trilogy about certain themes and ideas that were repeated over the three films. Do you agree with something like that? So I thought it was about
That's when I read your article for the first time. That was the first time, you know, like I'm hearing something like that, and I was really surprised. But you know, that's for you to decide. That's definitely for the viewer to interpret. And you know, I was really glad that you came up with that. At the same time, I had never thought about something like that. You know, like it must have been, you know, like some themes or something that has been bothering me, or in a way, I have been, you know, struggling with or something. It could be something like that.
So that was something I saw. I thought that it was about faith and this generational divide, and there were these people kind of grappling with them at different points of their life, but same idea. Yeah. So with that, what I wanted to ask is, there's a slight difference in the style from Sevam to the later films, which I thought maybe it is because you started editing these films, because the way they are shot also are a lot more different. In Sevam, the camera would move a lot more, but in the later two films, the actors would move within the frame a lot more. Mm-hmm. Was this a conscious choice, or is there a reason behind something like that?
With Sevam, I couldn't imagine Sevam being more subtle in the way the camera was set. It is possible to shoot passive observer standing somewhere far away, but you know, moving between them gave it a different kind of character, I guess. It gave a more dynamic nature to that film, I felt. But when it came to the other two films, I started, you know, like the way I started looking at people also kind of changed. And I wanted to, when I was shooting Sevam, I was actually getting involved in things. Like I was going after people and looking at what they were doing and all that. When I'm talking in the perspective of the camera, but when I was shooting the other films, I by that time I had watched a few other filmmakers, and I got more inspired by their style, and I started thinking why they are doing they went more subtle with the camera, and why would they be doing that, and I had my own reason. I found my own reason for doing the same, which is to be a more passive observer and not get too involved in the drama. Or, you know, also the later two films, they had a story. So it is too easy to get, you know, take a side of a character or the other. So I wanted to keep a distance from them, and at the same time, you know, show what's going on inside these characters.
With form, I still had one more doubt also. Like, you rather choose not to use music a lot in your film, kind of depend on the sound effects and the atmosphere of the place. So what is the reasoning behind that? Or like, are you averse to the idea of like maybe probing the audience in a way? Or like not put too many ideas in their head?
Yeah, like I said earlier about the camera movements, I didn't want to, you know, like tell the audience what to feel, you know, about each scene. I wanted to give the freedom to the audience in a way to feel what they want to feel. Because I had this interesting experience after shooting Sevam, after making that film. I got this opportunity to show that film to a lot of different audience in Kerala. I traveled all over Kerala and screened this film in various locations, like around 65 different places. And the reaction from the audience were, you know, extremely different. Like some people, like, you know, even though I imagined it, you know, almost as a satire, some people were crying after watching the film, literally. So that one thought struck me at that at point, that, you know, you cannot dictate over what one should feel about what you have already made. You know, you have the right to make whatever you want, but whatever the the viewer feels is in his or her own hands. So you didn't have any control over what other people would feel after watching the film. So when it came to making with and 1956, I had this viewpoint of like, okay, I will show whatever I want to show, but at the same time, I shouldn't dictate, you know, the viewer's feelings and emotions. So I left the emotional part for them. So when, as soon as you add music, you are telling them what to feel. So I had to be as subtle as possible about choosing the right music as well. So it shouldn't be directly dictating the viewer's emotion or the emotional experience of the film.
So with that note, so then I'll have another question regarding that, because that is very antithetical to how we see cinema in India. In India, it's about like how you can make someone laugh, how you can make someone cry, or like make someone angry, or like make them feel something, right? So what is your perspective towards cinema? What do you think, like, what is your goal? Like, what do you think of while you're making a film or conceptualizing it?
Yeah, I think it's two different kinds of approach. And you know, I, like you said, what I'm trying to get from the audience is different from what, you know, like majority of, or the mainstream film here, cinema here is doing. It's clear, like, you know, if you want to make people feel something, it's easy to evoke emotions through certain kind of camera movements or angles or lenses, the choice of lenses, or the even the music that you use. Like, all these devices are out there, and you know, it's, you can make them feel what you want to make them feel. And at the same time, if the audience are also you know, if that's what they also want to get out of the film, they can also feel the same and give you money, and you know, like, it's a simple business. But for me, I'm with each film, I'm trying to understand something a little bit more about the human nature itself. And so I want to, you know, I'm those people who watch my film are taking the same ride with me, and you know, they are going on the same journey with me. And you know, but it need not be exactly the same thing that they are also understanding. They cannot understand it in a different way. But I try to be as honest as possible, so that, you know, like, at the end of the movie, you or the audience would feel, you know, the audience would get something out of it, something fresh. Or, you know, like, if we both watch a movie, I honestly believe that we will be still be watching different films at the end. So like that, like, what I can do is to be as honest as possible. But, you know, people who watch the film would be getting different things from those films. So as long, and you know, like, with the pace also, I started going a little slower with my second film and third film, because I thought I, you know, I should give room for people to think, so that they can use their own history and their own imagination and everything in order to reach their own individual or independent conclusions.
So I'll get to my most exciting question. My thing was, I'm excited to watch your new film. I can't pronounce the Malayalam name because I'm really bad at Malayalam, but First Secret of Happiness, right?
Yeah.
So this thing is making a lot of hype everywhere. I've read so many reviews and articles about it, and it's supposedly like an 85-minute long take, right? Two people in a car. Could you tell us, or tell our audience, a little bit about it, or what's the idea behind it, and what is the movie?
Yeah, for me, it was a reflection on, you know, a dispute between a couple. At the same time, not without taking any particular side, because I even composed them in, you know, with giving both of them, you know, equal room on the screen, as well as, you know, like, around same time also. So, so that's for me, you know, like, it came also from, you know, the need of making that kind of a film, because we have all been in a confinement during the lockdown period and everything. And when we came out of it, you know, most of us spend our time with our partners, or you know, like especially in those in a romantic relationship or in marriage, or like people were spending their time with their partners at that time. So the idea of, you know, like that is portrayed in Indian films, especially about a romantic couple, is it doesn't really reflect in our everyday life. So I wanted to show a more truthful truthful portrayal of, you know, a relationship. But again, it was a character study, so it doesn't talk about every relationship out there. I was trying to be as specific as possible about, you know, these two particular characters. What would happen if two people who have these particular characteristics get into a relationship, and if they take this journey, like I am the one who is giving them this different situations, and this plot. The plot is something that the director or the writer gives them, but you know, like the character, once they are in the character, like, you know, the character drives the film. So it was like me trying to understand what these people would do.
Also, in form wise, it seems slightly different from your other films, which I'm thinking you're tackling something funnier, which I'm very excited about.
It's interesting because when I watched the film at four different shows of IFFK in Kerala, in four different cities, the reaction was very different each time. Like people laughed at different points. In Trivandrum, people even clapped, even like, I don't want to name that city, but for me, like at some projections, people were clapping or laughing, or they were cheering for the parts where we had some chauvinistic comments, or you know, like very misogynistic comments. But for some other screenings, people were, you know, more empathetic towards the woman, and like so there was a difference in the attitude of the audience too. So I think, you know, like it was a very mixed bag when it comes to the reception of the audience.
It's very personal, right? The more personal it is, the more universal it is, I guess. And okay, so let's get to a little more general. Like, I wanted to know, what are your biggest influences when it comes to filmmaking? Right? It could be writers, filmmakers, people who influence your work and make you want to write or produce something.
For me, I try not to idolize anyone in particular too much, way too much. But I do like the style of filmmaking by many, you know, different filmmakers. For me, I try to concentrate more on individual works rather than entire body of work, because when it comes to the entire body of works, there would be, you know, many conflicting elements in some films I might like and some films I may not. For example, when I like later works of Belathar more than his previous works. With Tati's films, I like, you know, how he uses space and everything, but at some points I find his, you know, the comedy, the use of comedy a bit too loud at some points. But you know, like, it's all about taking what you want to take, and you know, rejecting what doesn't go in harmony with your way of thinking. For me, also Tarkovsky, also I like his later works more. I like Andrei Rublev, but I didn't enjoy Solaris that much. But later, when it came to nostalgia, I really enjoyed Sacrifice. I didn't enjoy that much. Like, but it's all subjective too. Like, you know, so I try to take inspirations from the works that I really enjoy.
One thing I wanted to know is, what are you working on next? What can we look forward to?
I have no clue. And I don't even know whether, you know, when I will make a next film. I have been writing a script for a friend, and I have, you know, almost finished that script, and I'm giving it him. But at the same time, for myself to direct, I don't know what's next, or, you know, when I'm going to do the next one. It comes from the need, you know, like not just from the need to do something, but a need for a film, like something, you know, like that search should be there. And if there is, you know, if you're not in that, you know, like in that mode to search, it doesn't really happen.
Makes sense. It's speaking like a true artist. Yeah. And yeah, I think we're done with the questions, Don. Thank you so much for your time. That was really great talking to you.
Thank you, Rajshekar. You know, I hope I didn't stumble too much.
No, that's all good. Awesome. Thank you so much, Don. Thank you so much. Great time talking.